Good morning, everyone. Good morning, and welcome to the Unitarian Society of Santa Barbara. I'm the Reverend Julia Hamilton, and I am delighted that you are here with us this morning, whether you're with us in our physical sanctuary or joining us online in our Zoom sanctuary. We are coming together as this loving community of seekers, striving to live with integrity, nurture wonder, and inspire the actions that transform us and transform the world. It is a wonderful Sunday to be coming together to reignite one of our favorite holiday traditions around here, our craft fair this Sunday. So I don't know if you've seen Parish Hall yet, but there's all kinds of fun crafts waiting for people of all ages. No experience with crafting necessary. So after the service, grab a cup of coffee or tea and join us for some crafting. If you're visiting with us this morning, we would love to get to know you better. You can stop by our welcome table or sign our online connection card. We would love to keep in touch and let you know about all the things that are going on in the life of this congregation through the holiday season and beyond. We have a couple of upcoming things I want to highlight, and that is that we are going to be activating our warming centers on Christmas Eve, no matter what the weather is, but we might get some more rain. And we still do have room for a few more volunteers to cook and serve the meal for the warming center on Christmas Eve. So if that's something that you would like to do, please email me and I'll add you to our special Christmas Eve team. And because we have a service at 9 o'clock, our fabulous jazz Christmas Eve service, you can serve on the warming centers and still not miss our Christmas Eve celebrations here in the sanctuary. So feel free to let me know if you'd like to participate. Many thanks to all of you who are serving on our warming center teams. We were activated last night and we are activated tonight and Monday night as well. So thank you to everyone who makes that possible. And if you want to contribute, but you can't be part of the volunteer team on Christmas Eve, there is still a way that you can help us celebrate with our neighbors and guests at the warming centers. We are going to be collecting baked goods on Christmas Eve to put into breakfast bags so we can send people off on Christmas morning with some homemade treats. So if you'd like to contribute some baked goods to our Christmas morning breakfast bags, go ahead and bake something up. Make sure they're individually wrapped and drop them off here on Christmas Eve where they'll be assembled and handed out the next morning. We have some other holiday events coming up. This Friday is our hanging of the greens. So if you want to participate in our beautification of our sanctuary for the holiday season, come on over Friday morning and help celebrate. There'll be some hot drinks and good cheer. And if you have any extra evergreens in your yard, or if you have a neighbor who's willing with their permission to let you cut some of their evergreens, we are collecting greens to be used in the decoration of our sanctuary. You can drop them off here all week, just under the portico. We also are going to be having our second annual solstice gathering at Goleta Beach on Wednesday, December 21st. This is a way to honor the turning of the seasons, to watch the sunset on the shortest day of the year and the beginning of the longest night, and to gather in good community out in nature on solstice. Talk to Charlotte Brigante if you'd like to know more about that solstice gathering. And of course, next Sunday is our holiday play where we will be celebrating with a fabulous multi-generational cast and of the latke who couldn't stop screaming, celebrating the intersection of so many holidays this time of year. I'm joined this morning by some fabulous singers and musicians who have stepped in while our choir director, Matthew, is recovering from COVID. And it's just a reminder that this season there are still a lot of viruses going around. So take a little extra care. Make sure that you and your friends and family stay healthy through the holidays. And thank you once again to everyone who is staying flexible, willing to jump in and help out so that we can continue to support each other in this community. I invite you now to take a breath, to settle yourself wherever you are, put aside your shopping lists or your busyness of the season, and allow yourself to be fully present here in this time and hour together as we let the sound of our bell connect us. I'd like to invite our chalice lighting family to come forward. And if you're joining us online and you have a candle or chalice ready to kindle along with us, go ahead and do so now. You can type chalice is lit into the chat. And I'd like to invite Kyle and Sarah and Dylan and Simon to share chalice lighting words this morning.
We've come to this time and this place to rediscover the wondrous gift of free religious community, to renew our faith in the holiness, goodness, and beauty of life, to reaffirm the way of the open mind and full heart, to rekindle the flame of memory and hope, and to reclaim the vision of an earth made fair with all her people one.
Well done, everyone. It's going to be an exciting morning. Every Sunday, we also take a moment to put something into our virtual hope jar. This is that place where we lift up things that inspire us, things that renew our hope in the world and in each other. And this morning, for our collective entry into the hope jar, I want to celebrate the fact that the Respect for Marriage Act was passed, which is fantastic. If you want to cheer, you can. This will ensure that marriages between LGBTQ couples must be recognized throughout the nation. It repeals the Defense of Marriage Act that was signed in 1996. And although the Defense of Marriage Act was declared unconstitutional in 2015, it has stayed on the books ever since. And so passing this law repeals that terrible portion of our history and sets us on a path towards affirming the equity and rights of all individuals to marry whom they love. Let us begin by singing our first song together, O Tannenbaum, O Christmas Tree. Now you'll notice you have this insert in your order of service, and this has a lot of words on it. Don't worry, we're not going to ask you to sing in German. The words for two of our carols are presented in both German and then the other one in French, the original languages in which they're written. But they're just so that you can take a look if you want. We are going to be singing O Christmas Tree, the English version, which is on the inside of that pink sheet. Please rise in body and spirit and join us. Thank you. anyone who is young or young at heart and wants to come up and join me here on the rug, I have a little bit of a story about Christmas trees to share. You want to come on up and join me if you're a kid or a kid at heart? I know Charlotte's going to come up here. Fabulous. It gave you a chance to, you know, get a little change of scenery, see the sanctuary from a different perspective. Come on up if you want, because I want to know how many of you have a Christmas tree inside your house right now. Go ahead and raise your hand. And how many of you are going to get a Christmas tree sometime between now and Christmas, right? So this is something a lot of people do. A lot of places do it. You might have noticed them in stores and around towns. Now, what about singing? How many of you, and you can turn around and face me or you can face out if you want. That's okay. How many of you are going to sing some Christmas carols this time of year? Right. If you're here today, everybody should be raising their hand, right? And everybody at home. How many of you plan on giving gifts this time of year? Right. Maybe if you have parents, maybe you're going to give them some gifts. Maybe you can go make some gifts for them at the craft fair today. That's just a hint. Parents love things that you make for them. Now, there are all kinds of traditions that are lots of fun during the Christmas season. But what you might not know is that Christmas was not always celebrated this way. In fact, when the Puritans first arrived as colonists to this continent hundreds of years ago, they actually outlawed Christmas. Christmas was forbidden. It was illegal to celebrate Christmas. They didn't believe in celebrating anybody's birthday if you were a Puritan. Not even Jesus's birthday. And for nearly 150 years in New England, it was illegal to celebrate Christmas. You see, the Puritans had come over here from England. And back in England, Christmas was a pretty rowdy affair, right? It was mostly this pagan-inspired winter festival, and there was lots of singing and dancing in the streets and drinking wine and setting off firecrackers. And these were all things Puritans did not approve of. In fact, if it was fun, Puritans probably disapproved of it. So when they arrived here, they said they're going to put a stop to all of that Christmas nonsense and forbid anyone to celebrate Christmas. But over time, as more and more people from Europe and different parts of Europe started to arrive, the Puritans, originally from England, didn't have as much control over everybody's behavior anymore, and there was more room for other traditions to emerge. And so we're going to flash forward now to the early 1800s. And it was the Unitarians now, our Unitarian forebears, who were some of the most famous and influential people in New England. And the Unitarians had some big ideas about Christmas. Specifically, Unitarians at the time were really interested in how to raise good and kind and generous children. They put a lot of thought in how to raise a good kid. And this is very different from the Puritans, because the Puritans basically believed that kids were up to no good all the time. And that the only way you could make a kid behave was to punish them. So the Puritans were very, very strict. But the Unitarians said, hey, wait a minute. Maybe kids aren't all bad after all. Maybe if we just love them and teach them about kindness and generosity and helpfulness and make sure that everybody goes to school and gets a good education, well, maybe then they'll grow up into good and kind and thoughtful adults. I know this sounds like pretty standard stuff, but it was pretty revolutionary at the time to treat kids like they might be good little people. So some of the Unitarians had an idea. What if Christmas was a holiday that people of all ages could celebrate? And what if it was about kindness and generosity and family and peace? Does that sound familiar, Christmas themes to you, right? Well, in 1832, a Unitarian minister named Charles Fallon, who had been born in Germany but moved to the United States because he was a bit of a radical and his ideas got him into some trouble in Germany, he came here and he had an idea for his young son. He had grown up with a tradition of Christmas trees in his house, but nobody did that in New England because of the Puritans. So one night he had a Christmas party And he brought in a beautiful fir tree, and he put candles on all the branches, and he hung little sweets in little cups on all the branches, and put little toys in all the branches, and invited the whole community and all the kids over to his house to see this Christmas tree, the very first Christmas tree any of them had ever seen inside someone's living room. Because you can imagine the idea to bring a tree into your house, you know, it wasn't an obvious thing. So he shared this tradition that he loved as a child. And as luck would have it, there was someone at that party, someone who was pretty famous. And her name is on that window over there, Harriet Martineau. She was a Unitarian writer, and she was kind of like an influencer of her time, right? She would write about things and people would read them and they would start doing them too. And so she wrote about this Christmas party in Goody's Lady's book. And she wrote about how beautiful it was and how sweetly the children gathered around the tree and what a gorgeous scene. It brought tears to everyone's eyes. It was like posting an Instagram story at the time, right? Or making a TikTok video, and it went viral. And soon everybody wanted a Christmas tree in their very own living room, decorated with beautiful lights and sweets and ornaments to celebrate with the family. And so that's how come here in the United States, we put Christmas trees in our living rooms today. So when you celebrate Christmas, remember that this is not just about a wild party in the streets, but it's also about generosity and family and kindness, or as we might sing today, peace on earth and goodwill to all. So let's go make some presents. Right out here. Let's sing our kids up. Somebody left some crayons for me here on the chancel. So the idea for this service this morning came about while Matthew, our music director, and I were doing some planning for Christmas Eve. Now, I always like to include a song written by our Unitarian forebears on Christmas Eve, because a lot of our other favorite carols that we sing are, well, a bit Trinitarian for my taste. That is to say, I love singing the Alleluias and the big, vibrant joy to the worlds, but some of the verses get a little shaky theologically speaking. There's a lot of talk about God the King, which is not my preferred metaphor for the holy. But on Christmas Eve, I enjoy the singing of the traditional carols for the melody and the memories, and I set aside a lot of the theology and just focus on the song, especially the ones about the baby Jesus, more than the redeeming Christ. So I decided to do a little research into some of the Unitarian authors of some of our favorite carols, because I realized that on Christmas Eve, we don't usually have a lot of time to go into the stories behind some of these songs and traditions, and how these songs and traditions of our Unitarian forebears, even though some of the language might seem a little dated, it still is connected to our liberal theological positions about Christmas. So I thought this morning would be a fun time to do a bit of a deeper dive and explore what it means to celebrate the Christmas spirit through the words and traditions passed on to us by our Unitarian forebears. And so we're going to sing some of these songs today, and we're going to sing all the verses, which we don't often do, right? But I just encourage you to enjoy the singing and to listen for some of these threads that we're going to lift up in these songs. The next song we're going to sing is O Holy Night. This is a beloved Christmas classic that was created by an unlikely collaboration. It was a poem commissioned by a French Catholic priest, written by a socialist atheist winemaker, set to music by a Jewish opera composer and translated into English by a Unitarian minister, and then adopted as an abolitionist anthem in the lead up to the Civil War. So because it was commissioned by a Catholic priest in France in the 1840s, it still has some of that God the King language to wrestle with. But as we sing, I encourage you to pay attention to the abolitionist thread that runs through this song, especially in the third verse. So let us sing together, O Holy Night. The words are in that pink booklet. Again, I'm not going to ask you to sing the French. We're going to go straight to the English translation.
Thank you.
good work, everyone, hanging around with those high notes in there. Now, I don't know about you, but I don't know that if I've ever sung that song all the way through. Now, sometime around 1843, a Catholic priest in the Rhone Valley region of France approached a local winemaker, Placide Capot, who was known to write good poetry, but was also known to be very critical of the church. And the priest asked Capot to write a poem to celebrate the new organ in the local cathedral. And it is said that the priest was hoping that maybe this project would lead Capot back into the faith. Spoiler, it didn't work. But Capot did took on the challenge and enjoyed writing the poem and reached out to his friend, Adolphe Adam, who was a Jewish composer already well known for his operas, to write the music for the song. And the song became very popular in France for a while until the church authorities took a little closer look. And they thought that maybe a song written by an atheist socialist and music composed by a Jewish composer that had themes of anti-slavery in it was not something that the church could endorse. So they forbade the singing of that song at any church services in France. However, across the Atlantic, there was John Dwight Sullivan, who had been ordained as a Unitarian minister, but it wasn't working out very well for him. The stress of parish ministry caused him to go into somewhat of a breakdown, so he left his pulpit. And he ended up, because he was hanging out in the radical transcendentalist circles, he ended up being one of the organizers of Brook Farm, which was this utopian experiment in alternative living at the time. The transcendentalists were full of utopian ideas about how to live in better ways. Unfortunately, Brook Farm was unable to sustain itself. And in 1847, it collapsed. And so he was trying to figure out what to do with his life when he found his true calling, perhaps. And that was to be a music writer. He loved classical music, and classical music was exploding in Boston and New England at the time. And so he started a journal that became the preeminent music journal of his era. And in 1855, he came across this song, Cantique de Noël, and he translated it into English and published it in his journal as O Holy Night. Now, when he did that, he was also part of the abolitionist movement at the time. And this song caught the eyes of the movement because, O Holy Night, as we just sang, you can see how it talks about the worth of the human soul, about the law of love and the gospel of peace, about the emancipation of all who are enslaved. And although this was a Unitarian who translated the song, and it would be decades before the Unitarians and the Universalists would merge, you can see this very Universalist vision of love and liberation for all people everywhere embedded in this carol. And in researching the song, I learned that Christmas and the abolition movement have an interesting history. As the Unitarians were looking to the Christmas holiday to help raise kind and generous children, as we talked about in the story of the Christmas tree, they also turned to the Christmas holiday to awaken the conscience of the nation. The historian William Katz wrote, "In 1834, the newly formed Massachusetts Anti-Slavery Society saw Christmas as an opportunity to expose a republic that proclaimed liberty, yet held millions as slaves. Women assumed the lead, boldly defying a society that denied them a public voice or political opinions. To finance the abolition cause, these women organized Christmas bazaars that sold donated gifts and trumpeted anti-slavery messages in the name of the Prince of Peace and emancipation. These holiday bazaars also featured as their central decoration, guess what? The Christmas tree, inspired by Charles Fallon. And Fallon himself lost his teaching position at Harvard University in 1835 because of his abolitionist stance. So I loved learning this little tidbit about the Christmas bazaars because 200 years later, it felt so familiar. Right? How many times have we thrown events to raise money to fund justice efforts? How many times have we gathered together for craft fairs or concerts, learned anthems that help lift our hearts and build the world that we dream about? Reading these stories of these women organizing these Christmas fairs really made clear that thread in our history that carries forward even today. So this Christmas, let us follow the lead of our Unitarian forebears and remember that the Christmas story is a rich metaphor for the possibility of liberation and the affirmation of human worth and dignity embodied in every single child that is born. I'd like to invite you now into a time of meditation and reflection, a quiet time to lift up the prayers of your heart. And as you settle yourself wherever you are, perhaps you attend once again to your breathing, to your body in space, shared space in this gathered community. And as we enter into this quiet time of reflection, I invite you to extend compassion to all the places in the world where the struggle for liberation is ongoing. Iran, Ukraine, right here in our nation as trans siblings fight for their right to simply exist in peace and safety. And let us also lift up the countless personal struggles for liberation from addiction and despair, from abusive relationships or destructive patterns. May we extend our hope for healing and health, for a lifting of depression or a remission of disease, that all people everywhere may know that they are worthy and good and held in the arms of love. Let us enter into a time of quiet. So in your little songbooks there, and hopefully pasted into the chat online if you're joining us from home, there's a song that most of you won't need the lyrics to sing along with, at least not for the most famous parts. Jingle Bells is, after all, probably one of the most recognizable Christmas songs in the entire world, and you'll probably hear it several times before now and Christmas Eve. But we're not going to sing it together today. The lyrics are there for reference. And we're not going to sing it together partially because we just don't have time to sing through all of the songs that we might want to sing this morning, but also because I don't want to have you sing a merry song full of sweet childhood memories just to pull the rug right out from underneath you, because it's time for that part of the service, that part where I knock us off our pedestal a little bit and recognize that not all Unitarians were interested in goodness and justice and peace. And sometimes even the songs that we think are just for kids, beloved songs, can still be a little bit complicated. James Lord Pierpont, the author of Jingle Bells, he grew up in a prominent New England family. He was the son of an abolitionist Unitarian minister. His brother John also became a Unitarian minister. It's a lot of pressure on James. But James was not interested in the religious life. Despite working as a church musician for his brother when his brother took a pulpit in Savannah, Georgia, James was described by one scholar as a rebellious musician with a bad reputation. At the age of 14, for example, he ran away from the boarding school to join work on a whaling ship and was at sea for the next 5 years or so. Later on, he left his wife and kids in New England to come to California for the gold rush to try to strike it rich, failed at that, came home broke. And then he left his family in New England again to join his brother in Savannah, Georgia, where after his first wife, the one he'd left back in New England, died of tuberculosis, within a year, he'd managed to marry the mayor of Savannah's daughter and have a second family there. And then when the Civil War erupted, far from following in his family's abolitionist footsteps, he joined the Confederate Army as a company clerk and wrote several songs to encourage the Confederate troops in their work while his father was literally fighting on the opposite side as a chaplain in the Union Army. And Jingle Bells? What about that song? Well, it is claimed by both Medford, Massachusetts and Savannah, Georgia. There's long ongoing dispute over who gets to claim where the song was written. But the first public performance of Jingle Bells was documented in 1857 as part of a minstrel show in Boston, a troupe for whom Pierpont had written many songs over the years, which means that Jingle Bells was performed for the first time in blackface. It was not a particularly original song. There was a whole kind of body of work of slaying songs, right, that were performed as part of minstrel shows. And you might be wondering why I'm bothering to deconstruct this beloved song with you this morning. You might be wishing that I had not included it in the service at all. You might wish at times like I do that not everything had to be so complicated, even this beloved children's song. However, one of the principles of our faith is a free and responsible search for truth and meaning. Being responsible in the search for truth means that when we discover something uncomfortable, we don't shy away from it. We don't ignore it, but rather that we are willing to learn and evolve and grow with the knowledge we gain. We're willing to turn a critical eye on our own history, not just the world out there. To embrace the holiday spirit doesn't mean we have to leave our conscience at the door. Rather, it's an invitation to find a way towards this kind of more spiritually mature sense of joy and celebration, a joy that is not so fragile that it can be shattered by learning that a favorite song was written by a morally bankrupt individual. My joy is not that fragile, and I hope yours isn't either. When we discover these challenging stories, we have a choice. We can plug our ears and sing louder to drown out the truth, or we can embrace the opportunity to learn from our history, to learn how to do better, not just from the shining examples of people who led the way, but also from places where our ancestors missed the mark. After all, as Maya Angelou so beautifully said, do the best you can until you know better. Then, when you know better, do better.
Ooh, happy holidays. Today's offertory is dedicated to the Freedom Warming Centers. Freedom Warming Centers has been a Unitarian priority since 2010 and is one of the great success stories about how we get involved in the community and help out those that may have less than we do on an everyday basis. We will be giving and donating 25% of our plate this week for the Freedom Warming Centers. For those that may not know about them, the warming centers were inspired and named for a Santa Barbara resident by the name of Freedom, who died on the streets in and around 2009. The program was an effort to reduce and eliminate the chances of anyone else dying from winter conditions in Santa Barbara County. We are one of a number of faith-based community partners that help support the program. Today, it is now at 12 locations throughout the county. It originally started here, so it's something that we are very, very proud of. So if you will join with me in our affirmation of gratitude and giving, let us be grateful when we're able to give, for many do not have that privilege. Let us be grateful for those who share their gifts with us, for we are enriched by their giving. And let us be grateful even for our needs, so that we may learn from the generosity of others.
So as I mentioned, we are still adapting and pivoting. And so the song that we are about to hear, Do You Hear What I Hear, for our offertory, has been graciously shared with us in a recording that a sister congregation in Redwood City made. And before we listen to this song, I just want to give you a little bit of context. In October of 1962, the Cuban Missile Crisis brought the world to the brink of nuclear war. Songwriter Noel Regney was walking in New York City with his heart heavy when he saw some mothers strolling with their babies, and he decided to write a song as a prayer for their future. And he asked his wife, Gloria Shane, to write the music. It was released quickly that year in Thanksgiving and became an instant success. And Noel would later move to Connecticut and join the Unitarian Universalist congregation in Westport.
See what I see, veiled in the sky, little lamb.
Star, the star, that's seen in the night, with a tail as big as a car.
Many thanks to our sister congregation and good wishes to our choir members and our choir director who are recovering from their COVID exposure. I'd like to invite Gary and Keir to join me for this next piece. This is a poem written by Unitarian author Henry Wadsworth Longfellow. The text of the poem is on the back of that pink sheet in your order of service, and I can see the sky has changed outside, and the next round of rain might be sweeping through. Longfellow wrote this poem on Christmas Day of 1864, after his son Charles was wounded while fighting in the Civil War.
I hear the bells on Christmas Day, the old familiar carols play, and wild and sweet the words repeat, of peace on earth, goodwill to men.
And thought how, as the day had come, the belfries of all Christendom had rolled along the unbroken song of peace on earth, goodwill to men.
Till ringing, singing on its way, a voice, a chime, a chant sublime of peace on earth, goodwill to men.
Then from each black accursed mouth, the cannon thundered in the south, and with the sound, the carols drowned of peace on earth, goodwill to men.
It was as if an earthquake rent the hearthstones of a continent and made forlorn the households born of peace on earth, goodwill to men.
And in despair, I bowed my head. There is no peace on earth, I said, for hate is strong and mocks the song of peace on earth, goodwill to men.
Then pealed the bells more loud and deep. God is not dead, nor doth he sleep. The wrong shall fail, the right prevail, with peace on earth, goodwill to men. If there is one overarching theme that Unitarians bring to the way we sing about Christmas, it's this longing for a more peaceful world. You can hear it in the old-fashioned language of Longfellow's poem, in the more modern lyrics of Do You Hear What I Hear? And its core message of the final song that we're singing in just a moment, It Came Upon a Midnight Clear. It Came Upon a Midnight Clear was written in 1849 by the Reverend Edmund Sears of Wayland, Massachusetts. And it was deeply influenced by his pacifism in response to the Mexican-American War, as well as his commitment to abolition. It's notable for A Christmas Carol that this song doesn't mention the baby Jesus at all. Not even once. And for this reason, it's actually been kind of set aside from some of the more conservative and traditional Christian denominations. Instead, this song focuses on the song of the angels, a song of peace that feels timeless and powerful. In this carol, Sears tells us that this song of peace is a constant refrain in the world, always there, always being sung, always present, if only we human beings could cease our fighting long enough to hear it. Perhaps I love this carol because it manages to be both kind of sweetly melancholy, but yet still ultimately hopeful. It harbors no illusions about the presence of war and strife, of toil and pain. And yet it says, and yet that suffering is not the be-all and end-all of existence. Underneath our troubles, there is another truth, that peace is always possible. There is a persistence of hope. There is a gentle grace to the world as well. The Christmas spirit, as Sears wrote about it, resides in that quiet moment when we pause from our daily routines and attend to the singing of the heavens. And inspired by that song, then go out to work for peace in a hurting world. To, as he says, return the song back to the heavens. Now, we don't often sing all five verses of the song, but it's our last carol, and I know you can do it. So today, we're going to do the whole thing. So please join me and just let yourself enjoy the singing. It came upon a midnight clear. Thank you all for joining me on this little journey through our Unitarian Universalist Christmas heritage. It was a good reminder to me, and I hope it is to you, that as we move through this season, the story of Christmas is rich with metaphors of peace and liberation and love that can nourish our spirits and feed our souls if we take a moment to rest and let that song filter into our lives. As you go out into this beautiful and heartbreaking world, this beautiful and heartbreaking rain, may the light of love shine upon you, out from within you, be gracious unto you and bring you peace. For this is the day we are given. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. Now let us call out a blessing.